Hello once again. We're excited that you are there. And we are here. And we are here to worship the Lord. So just go ahead and join us right wherever you're at.
Be your name, Jesus. the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name.
We thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. We honor you today. We bless the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Yo saki araraba. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Bless
It's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before us, let me be singing when the evening comes.
Let's sing that again.
The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the
your holy name. worship the holy name of Jesus. The name of Jesus is greater. The name of Jesus is stronger. The name of Jesus is high above all things. The name of Jesus is bigger. The name of Jesus has power. Oh, yes. The name of Jesus is high above all.
Jesus, come, Lord Jesus.
We thank you, Lord, for the power of your name. There is no other name that brings healing, that brings freedom, that brings victory. It's in the name of Jesus. And we lift you up. We thank you for who you are. No matter the situation, my heart will choose to say, blessed be the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Man, well, I'm enjoying our time of worship, but I will say this, I do miss the times when you're in church on a Sunday morning and when the presence of the Lord moves over a real congregation that's in a church. There's something very special that happens because different people respond different ways, and you sense all that, you feel all that, and something great takes place. I do want to say, the good news is this, our governor has basically said that churches can come back to worship. However, it's really just saying that churches now have the option to make their choice. So we've chosen, because of where Iowa is right now, and of course our concern is the state really hasn't come to the peak of the activity of the virus. So we're just going to hold off until May 15. Then we'll let you know. We'll give you more information. But I do want to say this. Our comeback celebration is around the corner. And thank God for that. So we're almost there. So stay encouraged. Amen. Take your Bible, if you would, if you're at home or wherever you may be, or your device. And I'm in Philippians, the fourth chapter. Philippians 4. Verses 4 to 7, and we've been on a little journey, and I haven't really done an expository series, but I have done kind of a preaching series through the book of Philippians, where we've really been focused on the whole idea of facing an uncertain future, and this is probably the last message in that series. But Philippians 4:4-7, the Apostle Paul says, "Rejoice in the Lord always. And again I say, rejoice. Let your moderation be known unto all men. The Lord is at hand. Be careful for nothing, but in everything, by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known unto God. And the peace of God, which passeth all understanding, shall keep your hearts and your minds through Christ Jesus." So he said, there's something called the peace of God. It passes understanding. It keeps your thoughts, and it keeps your emotions, and it brings all that, you could say, into a place of focus. Let's pray together, and then we'll get into the Word. And I really do believe that the Lord has something for someone as we open the Word of God. So let's pray. Lord, we love you. We thank you, Lord, for a peace that comes from you, God, that is beyond anything, Lord, that we fully understand. We're incapable of it. And Lord, I just pray. I pray today that we not only could experience that, but that we could get into the place, Lord, where our hearts and our minds, God, really, truly are kept by it. And I ask you, Lord, today that you would just come, let your anointing touch us wherever we are. We pray your kingdom would come. We pray your will would be done. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. 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 In Jesus' name. Amen. So this is usually where I would say you may be seated. But I want to really focus on the subject, the peace that passes understanding. The peace that passes understanding. Paul is writing the book of Philippians from a prison in Rome, writing to a church at Philippi. He's confined, he's facing what we would call an uncertain future, and yet he's saying, rejoice in the Lord always. And by the way, I'm telling you, you should rejoice. He tells the church, he said, the God that started you on this journey, not only did he start you on the journey, so I always say, and I'm thankful for it, if you came to the church because, whatever reason, other than God drew you, or if you joined the church by shaking someone's hand or whatever, I don't know how you think you join it, but if that's the way you got into the church, well, then you're in trouble. But if you're born again of the water and of the Spirit, if you come in because the Spirit of God reaches out and draws you to it, and God is the one that starts you on the journey, like Jesus told Nicodemus, you must be born again. If this really is your experience, you're birthed in because God does it, the good news is this: if God started you on the journey, well, He'll keep you all the way. And so Paul says, being confident of this very thing, this is the way he starts in Philippians 1 and verse 6, he which hath begun a good work in you will perform it to the day of Jesus Christ. In other words, let this sink down. Let it be something that is settled in your mind and in your spirit. Whatever comes on the journey as you're walking with the Lord, whatever it is, God will give you something internally that's greater than whatever it is that's coming externally, so that you will be able to continue all the way to the day of Jesus Christ. So here's the good news. This is the one thing I can tell you about what we're going through right now. This will not stop the church of the living God. This is the one thing I know for sure, because God is the one that started us on this journey, and God is the one that will see us all the way through. So Paul is saying, look, I'm confined right now. I'm on a shorter chain than I want to be on. I'm stuck in a situation I don't necessarily enjoy. I feel limited. I feel handicapped. And yet, the reality of it is, this is not necessarily a huge obstacle for God. This is actually an opportunity for God. And so he said, even though I can't preach the way I used to preach, even though I can't go into communities like I used to, start churches, reach to people, he said, even though I have to use different methods, and now Paul picks up his pen and he starts to write, and he sends out these letters. And by the way, you would say probably you and I are benefited more by what he did while he was in prison and confined than we do by him just when he was out preaching, because today we get to pick up something that's not just written by a man, but it's literally inspired by or breathed on by the Spirit of God. And as he's sitting there in his prison cell and he starts writing this stuff, God's Spirit comes to visit him. And he starts sending this message out to the church. He sends it through a man by the name of Epaphroditus. And he comes back to the church with this letter. And he, I don't know if he's reading it in front of the church. I don't know how they're getting this to the church, this message. But he starts reading the words of this apostle that started the church, that founded the church in Philippi. And the message is simply this: as they're sitting there thinking, we don't know what their future holds, we don't know where all this is going, we don't know what's around our corner, Paul the apostle, he said, here's how I want you to deal with it. He said, I'm telling you, this is what's working for me, and it's going to work for you. Literally, he says in the same chapter, he said, you just do what I'm doing. In other words, it's working here for me, so you try it yourself. I want you to rejoice in the Lord always. And again, I'm telling you, I want you to rejoice. And then he says, I want you to know you need to pray. And when you pray, instead of worrying, the peace of God is going to come and it's going to help you through difficult times. Amen. Jesus said these words. So I'm reading from John 14 and verse 24. He said, peace I leave with you. My peace I give unto you, not as the world gives, give I unto you. Let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. So Jesus, by the way, wherever he was, wherever Jesus was, there was peace all the time. Even if Jesus was in a boat and there was a storm surrounding the boat, there was still peace that was there. And of course, when Jesus went to the bow of the boat and just spoke peace, peace came out of him and it was wherever he was. And so as long as Jesus was there, there was peace. And he said, I don't want you to be anxious about anything. Don't let your heart be troubled. Don't let it be frightful. Don't let it be agitated. Don't get panicked. Don't get full of fear. He said, I want to be there with you always. But he told his disciples when they were fearful and he was leaving, he said, don't worry. He said, actually, it's going to be better that I go away, because if I go away, I can send a comforter back to you. If I'm not here physically, I can actually be not with you, but I can be in you. So he said, my peace I leave not just surrounding you or walking with you, but literally I can leave it inside of you. And so Jesus said, this is what's going to happen. My peace will be internally in your life. I will not leave you comfortless. I will be there. I will come to you. And so you could say the world that we're living in doesn't have peace. It's full of turmoil. It's full of its struggles and problems. It's full of agitation. It's full of difficulty. And yet Jesus said, here's what I'm going to leave behind. When I leave, I'm going to leave people that have peace. They're going to be in a world full of anxiety, but my people will have peace. Amen. I'm going to give it to their heart. I'm going to give it to their mind. They're going to be able to sleep at night. You could say they won't be fearful of the terror by day or the terror by night. They'll get up in the morning. They'll have a season of prayer. They'll get direction from the Lord. They'll be able to see the hand of the Lord operating. They'll be able to see God at work. They'll understand that the angel of the Lord encamps round about those that fear the Lord, and they'll be able to go forward. They'll be able to live in peace. And Paul said, this is the way my people will operate. They're going to operate with a secret strength, a secret wisdom, a secret power, in a secret peace that is on the inside of them, that nothing from this world will be able to penetrate. The enemy won't be able to come in, because they'll be garrisoned, they'll be surrounded by, there'll be a fence around them of peace that will not allow the enemy to come into their spirit, their mind, their heart. Amen. There's something very powerful that's at work, and it's a peace of God that's at work in their life. So he said, I want you to realize these are the principles by which the peace of God works. He said, number one, I want you to rejoice in the Lord always. And again, I say, rejoice. Regardless of what comes your way, develop a lifestyle in which you are rejoicing consistently in the Lord. And he said, I can't overemphasize this. I have to tell you, this is the way it really is. I want you to rejoice always in the Lord. David put it like this. The psalmist said, Psalm 34, he said, I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. My soul shall make her boast in the Lord. The humble will hear thereof and be glad. And then he said, oh, magnify the Lord with me, and let us exalt his name together. I sought the Lord, he heard me, and he delivered me from all my fears. He said, I will bless the Lord not sometimes, but I will bless the Lord at all times. There'll be something in my mouth that will be praising God continually. So he said, good days, I bless the Lord. Bad days, I bless the Lord. Happy days, I bless the Lord. Sad days, I bless the Lord. Sunny days, I bless the Lord. Rainy days, bless the Lord. I mean, you fill in the blank. He said, I want you to understand, this is the way that I'm going to go at life. And he said, when I do this, when I get in this mode of blessing the Lord continually, when I get in this mode where the praises from my lips start to magnify the Lord and lift up the Lord, he said, suddenly I start to magnify the Lord. I start to realize that God is actually bigger than my problems, bigger than my trouble, bigger than everything else that's around me. And he said, the Lord hears me, and there's a delivering power in my life that delivers me from all of my fears. So Paul said, I'm really serious about this first part of everything. He said, you have got to learn how to bless the Lord. Maybe I should put it like this. You need a spirit of praise in your life. It's a wonderful thing when a church has a spirit of praise in the church, because there's joy when people praise God. There's a sense of deliverance when people praise God. When you begin to praise the Lord, it's like something goes to war for you. Everything changes. The atmosphere changes. Your entire day changes in an atmosphere of what you could call real, true, biblical praise. And the Apostle Paul said, I'm not just talking about getting ourselves souped up emotionally. I'm just talking about really, truly expressing something powerful to God, allowing that to flow up and out of your life. He said, this is what you need to do consistently in your life. You need a spirit of praise in your life. Isaiah 61 verse 3, he said, there's beauty for ashes. There's the oil of joy for mourning. There's a garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness. The Apostle Paul said, ask God to give you a spirit of praise. Ask God to give you an anointing of joy. Ask the Lord to come and touch you with a garment of praise that can lift every heaviness that comes against your life. Amen. Come in rejoicing in the presence of the Lord. Amen. Thank the Lord. Paul said, and then I want you to understand, you should be careful for nothing. The Greek literally means not one thing. So he said, don't worry about anything. And then he says, and by the way, not even one little thing. So it's not like, well, just don't worry. He said, even if it's a little thing, like don't even let little things pull you down. He said, don't worry about any little thing, but you should pray about everything. So you should bring everything to the Lord in prayer. And the peace of God will help you. It'll keep your thoughts. It'll keep your mind. It'll help you if things are weighing down. I'm sure you've never had this happen. If things are weighing down on your mind, if you can't focus properly, if things are weighing down on your emotions, and once again, I'm sure this has never happened to you, or at least if it has, pretend like it hasn't. If things are weighing down on your emotions, I've heard people say people don't burn out because they have to solve problems. They burn out because they have to solve the same problem over and over and over again. So whoever it is I'm talking to that's facing the same problem over and over again, something that doesn't fix in your life, something that doesn't ever seem to go away, and it seems like that thing is weighing you down. Amen. The Apostle Paul said, I'm here to tell you, there is a breakthrough in your life that God has for you in that area of your life. And he said this, the solution is not stopping one thing. You can't focus your mind if your mind is struggling or weighed down. You can't just stop the emotional feelings if your emotional feelings are already on the roller coaster. He said, I'm not telling you just to stop something. I'm telling you to start something else. He said, you need to get into a place where there is a spirit of prayer that comes on your life until the peace of God that passes understanding starts to take over in your life. Amen. Thank the Lord. I was working through all this today, and I was thinking about preaching the peace of God and throughout the week. And there's so many ways you could end a sermon like this, so many places you can go, so many things to be said. But I was just reading through the scripture all over again. And I want to challenge this church. We are, and I'm thankful for it, we are a church that believes in prayer. We've got prayer meeting every Saturday. I'm thankful to tell you the prayer meeting is probably better attended now than ever. And I'm thankful. I believe God has given this church a spirit of prayer. I believe that with all of my heart. And I do not believe people pray just because they want to pray. Like, there's not a bunch of people that just say, oh, let's go to the church and pray. Like, that is not what people just want to do naturally. So I really believe God is doing that in this church. I said it the last time we had a prayer meeting just before we had to shut everything down. I was looking around the group that was there, and I was amazed by who was there at the prayer meeting. I mean, and I started mentioning to people, some people we prayed for a long time that that all of a sudden they started feeling a desire to come and get involved in the things of God. And they came to the prayer meeting. And I was looking around the room and I was saying, this is a very unlikely group of people, because can you imagine, even if you'd look back 3-4 years, can you imagining the people that are here even tonight, and young people and different people that throughout their life, maybe they would be involved in prayer, maybe they wouldn't be involved in prayer, and how God's reached out to some of them and quickened them and worked in them, and some amazing things have happened. And I'm thankful for the drawing power of God's Spirit and a spirit of prayer that's been on this church. But here's what I came to tell you today, and that is simply this. I believe God is calling us to another level. Paul said, there is something that passes understanding. There's something beyond where you've ever been before. There's something beyond what you've ever sensed before. And this is Paul writing to a church. He'd been in prison there before. He had seen the power of praise and prayer before. He had seen God literally shake the foundation of the prison. He had seen a place of deliverance where not just some bonds were set free, but where every band was loosed, where all the doors were open. He had seen God do amazing things, and I believe with all my heart, this church has seen God do amazing things. We don't have to have someone come and tell us, you need to pray. We know we need to pray. We don't need someone to tell us the answers are in the prayer room. We know the answers are in the prayer room, but I'm just here to tell you, I believe with all my heart, God is calling us to another level where we've never been before. And I never want to go back. I want to see us break through a barrier into a supernatural place where God is doing amazing things beyond our understanding. And I believe that's where the peace is, but I think that's where other things are too. Jeremiah 33 in verse number 1-3. Jeremiah, the prophet in the Old Testament, says these words, "Moreover, the word of the Lord came unto Jeremiah the second time while he was shut up in the court of the prison." It's kind of interesting. That's where he was, in prison at this time, saying, "This is what the Lord, the maker thereof, the Lord that formed it to establish it, the Lord is his name, call unto me, and I will answer you and show you great and mighty things which thou knowest not." God came to Jeremiah, and Jeremiah knew God. Jeremiah had prayed many times. Jeremiah was not a novice. Jeremiah was a powerful prophet of God that stood, by the way, when other people were not standing for God. He was faithful when other people were not faithful. He preached at a very difficult time to a culture that was drifting away, far away from the things of God. And yet God came to Jeremiah and he said, "Jeremiah, I'm calling you to a whole nother place. I'm calling you to something that's beyond where you've ever been before. Call on me and I will answer, and I will show you great and mighty things that right now you do not know." In other words, whatever your experiences has been in God. And by the way, there's kind of a fluid zone, you could say, that we live in the Lord. How many of you understand this? In other words, sometimes you feel like you're really connected to God. Sometimes you feel like your connection to God is better than other times. So you could say if there's a zone you live in, sometimes you feel like you're up here. Sometimes you feel like you're kind of down here. And hopefully every time you go up, you get a little higher high. And every time you go down, you don't go quite as low. I think if we're just honest, we would say we all live in kind of a zone like that, where maybe we just kind of go up and we kind of go down. Sometimes we're closer to God. Sometimes we get into prayer and fasting. Sometimes we get really committed and consecrated. And then other times we just kind of drift maybe a little bit, you could say. But God called Jeremiah and he said, "Jeremiah, I want you to break through the ceiling. I want you to go to the place where you've never been before. He said, I want you to call on me. I'm going to answer you in a way that's not in your mind. It's not something you've conceived before. You're not thinking, well, God, I'm going to pray this prayer, and then I'm going to lay out all these five things, and then I know that you can do that because I could do that. No, he said, I want to take you to a place where you knock on the door of heaven, where you pray, God, let your kingdom come. God, let your will be done. I want to bring you to a place where mighty things begin to break out around your life. I want you to take you to that kind of place where you break through that barrier, whatever it has been before, and you start going to a place that's beyond your understanding. I'm going to show you great and mighty things. Amen. I feel this in my spirit today. Amen. I believe with all of my heart. Now listen, I'm not saying what we're going through is a positive thing in any way. I know there's a lot of hurting people. I know it's very difficult. But I do know this. God can use it for a very powerful purpose. God can take evil things and God can turn them around for your good and for my good. And I think the Apostle Paul, as the elder, was speaking to that young church in Philippi, and he was saying, I want you to understand what I'm going through right now, what has happened to all of us right now. He said, God is bringing us to a place, and we are never going back. We are never turning back. God is shifting something. God is doing something. God's creating something in which we are dependent on Him, not partially, but fully. God is taking you and I to a place where not only do we need to pray, but as we pray, we're seeking deeper and deeper levels and places in God. And He said, if you call on me from a place like that, I will answer, and I'm going to show you great and mighty things. And I really believe what happened was the Apostle Paul started to pray in ways he had never prayed before. And he said, I'm telling you, I know what happened in Philippi. I know what happened when those doors opened up and everyone's chains were loosed. I know the supernatural power of God, but I'm here to tell you God is even greater than that. God is even more powerful than that. I prayed to be delivered. I wasn't delivered in the way I thought I'd be delivered. I wasn't delivered physically, but I was delivered. I was set free in my mind. And he said at the end of the book of Philippians, he said, even people in Caesar's house are getting saved. There is a revival that's breaking out all over Rome because God has me in this place. He said, don't feel sorry for me. I'm set free inside. It's surpassing anyone's understanding. It's beyond anything you can imagine. God has taken me to another place in Him. Amen. This is where I would say stand with me, and we're going to pray together. If you're at home, certainly, I want you to take a little time and reach out to the Lord. But I really didn't just kind of come with what I would call a warm, fuzzy feeling. Usually when I preach peace, it's just encouragement. I want to encourage you, certainly. I want to see you lifted, certainly. But I really want to close this last message from Philippians with a strong challenge. I don't ever want to be the same. I don't want our church to ever be the same. I believe God is calling us to a deeper place in His Spirit. So let's pray together, and then we'll worship for just a little while together. Amen. Jesus, we love You. We thank You, Lord, for the power of Your Spirit. We thank You, Lord Jesus, God, for Your Word. I thank You, Lord, for what You're doing in the lives of every individual, Lord. Maybe there's someone that's a member of New Life Church and You're trying to bring them to a deeper level. Maybe there's someone who's been listening to these messages or viewing them online, and God, they're fringing. They don't even know much about You, Lord, but something from Your Spirit's been reaching to them, touching them, dealing with them, and You're encouraging them to step up a little bit higher. It's beyond a place they've ever been, but You're calling them, You're drawing them, You're pulling on them, and I pray for them right now. Lord God, that there would be something in their heart that would begin to reach out in your direction. And more than that, Lord, that there would be a peace, God, from you that would start to help them to understand, Lord, where it is that you're drawing them, what it is that you're doing in their life. I pray, Lord, as a church, God, as the New Life Church, Lord, that we would never be the same. We don't want to see natural things. We want to see supernatural things. We want to see you at work. We want to see your hand at work, Lord, among us. Oh, God, we're going to call out on you. We know that you're going to answer. You're going to show us great and mighty things. I pray, Lord, as we pray, if there's someone's heart, if there's someone's emotions that are out of control, there's someone that's panicking, if there's someone's mind, Lord Jesus, that things are just weighing them down, they struggle to sleep or they're struggling, Lord, to focus, I pray, Lord Jesus, that you would help them, Lord God, right now. Send a foretaste, Lord, of that peace that passes understanding. Give them a touch of your spirit right now, Lord God, that allows them to know you're the one that's doing that in their life. In Jesus' name we pray. Thank you for it, Lord. Amen.
Amen. In the secret place of the Most High, it's where I abide. It's where I abide. give my all.